If you weren't here last week, we actually got into a new sermon series. And what we're doing here in this sermon series throughout the rest of the summer is we're covering the contents of the book of Ecclesiastes, which you can find in the Old Testament of your Bibles. And throughout this book, what you find is there's a man named Solomon who kind of goes on a journey to find meaning in his life. And he goes through many different pursuits and different activities in his life trying to find meaning without God actually being there. Okay, so he tries to avoid God, even though he knows he's there, and try to find meaning in things without him. Solomon is commonly known as the smartest and the wisest and the richest man probably ever to have lived on this planet. He was a king of Israel from 970 BC to 931 BC. And so what that means is he had unlimited resources and he had unlimited knowledge in which he could conduct kind of a social experiment, is what he does in this pursuit of finding meaning by making, in the search of finding meaning without God being the center of any of it. Like, I'm just going to put God there, I'm going to do my thing, and I'm going to try to see if I can find meaning. Now, the reason this experiment is so fascinating to me and why it's so relevant to us is this. Much of what he experienced and much of what he had as opportunities before him and also the temptations before him are very similar to what we deal with in our lives today. The difference between him and us is just simply this. He had zero limits, okay? He was a king. He was incredibly wise. He had unlimited money, so he could pursue anything he wanted without limits. That is also very important information and valuable information for us as well. Because one of the things Satan does in our lives is this, is he convinces us if we could just do more in the pursuit of the things of this world, that we could actually find the meaning we're looking for. What makes Solomon's attempt here so fascinating is he did everything to the extreme. He did everything without limits. He did everything you could ever possibly dream and think of, and he was able to do that. And then what he does in the book of Ecclesiastes is he kind of provides us with the results of these different pursuits that he goes after. And what makes it interesting is he's very systematic about it. So he'll be like, I'm going to pursue this. I'm going to pursue that. I'm going to pursue this. And then he'll pursue it. And then in the book, he kind of goes, and this is what I got out of it. What he often describes it as is this, meaningless. Okay? Now, in the English language, that's how we translate this Hebrew word. The actual Hebrew word, if you were here last week, I spent some time walking through this. The actual Hebrew word is hevel. And what hevel means is it's a smoke or a vapor. Okay? And so he describes all these pursuits as hevel, meaning you can see there's something there, something you want. When you go try to grab it and attain it, it's gone. It doesn't last. It's so brief and it's so just for a second that it's gone, and you realize the thing I thought I was capturing, the thing I thought I was getting, this thing of meaning, it doesn't work, and all I'm left with is hevel. I'm left with nothing. And so that's how he describes all these endeavors. Now, last week, the way we started this series is we started to talk about that you cannot find meaning in your life that's eternal if you decide not to honor God with your life. If you just decide to do it on your own and go, my pursuit is not about honoring God, it's impossible to find eternal meaning in your life. You will never actually be satisfied. So today what we're going to do is this. We're going to start to dig into the details of his social experiment. And that's what we're going to do the next several weeks, is we're going to go through the details of the social experiment that he runs with himself as kind of the guinea pig, and looking at what he found in them and the pursuits that he followed. So in chapter 2 of the book of Ecclesiastes, Solomon today, he's going to pursue two things, pleasure and the acquiring of possessions. So he's going to go, can I find meaning in my life without God if I just pursue possessions and pleasure, and I just pursue those things out of my life? Here's what he says, and here's how this pursuit goes. Starting in chapter 2, verse 1 of Ecclesiastes, he says this, I said to myself, come on, let's try pleasure. Let's try for the good things in this life. But I found that this too was meaningless. So I said, laughter is silly. What good does it do to seek pleasure? After much thought, I decided to cheer myself with wine. And while still seeking wisdom, I clutched at foolishness. And This way, I try to experience the only happiness most people find during their brief life in this world. Let me explain what he went after here, and where he says, I kind of experience the thing that most people only experience. The only, how's he say it here? I experience the only happiness most people find during this brief life in this world. The culture he went after here, the first thing he tries out, is the drinking and just being an idiot route, okay? Which is, I'm going to work, even if I work hard, then I'm going to go home, I'm going to drink, I'm just going to do foolish stuff, dumb stuff, just try to enjoy stuff and be stupid and enjoy life that way. We think a lot of times when you hear this, we're talking about like our teenage years and our early college years. But we all know a lot of adults who do this a majority of their life. That their pursuit in life and their only happiness they find is, I go off, I work, I come home, I have some drinks, I go try to be stupid, I try to forget about all the other problems in the world and my other problems, and I just try to enjoy the moment and be happy. And he goes, that was my first pursuit. I did that one. A lot of people, that's as good as it ever gets for them. And he says, so I did that one. Then he goes on in verses 4 through 6, he says this, I also tried to find meaning in building huge homes for myself and by planting beautiful vineyards. I made gardens and parks, filling them with all kinds of fruit trees. I built reservoirs to collect the water and irrigate my many flourishing groves. So the next thing he does is this. That one I tried. Now I'm going to try to attain my dream home. That's the best way I can describe it to us in current day words. I'm going to get my dream home. It's going to have a beautiful yard. I'm going to have all the plants and the flowers. It's going to be beautiful there. And I'm going to have the house that I've always wanted. I'm going to move into that. And that's going to give me meaning. Okay? If you've ever been in this place, this is odd, because I'll just give you, I've mentioned this before. Me and Autumn, when we first moved here, moved into into our house in Owosso. I remember we used to sit back, remember this, and we'd be like, I can't believe we live in this house. Okay? Because where we grew up in, both of us pretty much in poverty situations, we live in Owosso, we come from Detroit, and the market here was like maybe 40% of the cost of the Detroit market when we moved here. And so we buy a new house in this new city outside in the suburbs. We had a half-mile green belt behind us. I used to, like, mow paths through that I could hike with my kids and everything that we looked out into, and it was this grass field with trees all over the place, and, like, a swamp back behind it we could go to. It had beaver dam and stuff in it. We could just go back there. What did he say? No alligators. No, we never saw the alligators, but no. So we had that, and I remember we would sit back and be like, holy cow, we've got our dream. Sitting back and feeling like, look what we've accomplished. Holy cow, look where we are. Okay? That's what Solomon kind of does here. Is he goes, I'm going to build myself palaces, gardens, the dreams that everybody has to attain those things, I'm going to do it. And so that's what he does. In verses 7 through 8, he moves on. He says this, I bought slaves, both men and women, and others were born into my household. I also owned herds of flocks, more than any of the kings who had lived in Jerusalem before me. I collected great sums of silver and gold, the treasure of many kings and provinces. So the next thing he basically says is, I collected tons of money, and I had all the possessions anybody could ever want. So I went and got rich, I got my possessions, I had it all, and I pursued that, and so that's another pursuit I had, with just obtaining tons of money and tons of riches, and whatever I wanted, I went and bought, okay? Next thing he says, in verse 8, he says, I hired wonderful singers, both men and women, and I had many beautiful concubines. I had everything a man could desire. So now he brings two more in. These two are this. He entertained himself. So back then it was getting these beautiful singers or whatever. I went to entertainment and basically fulfilling every one of his warped little sexual desires. Okay? So he says here, I had many beautiful concubines. Just so you know who this guy was, he had 700 wives and 300 concubines. Now, what a concubine was, you weren't fully a wife, but you were just meant for me. And so we isolate you out of society, and you're just mine. And so he had 1,000 women that were devoted to him. Okay? So he pursues that, his warped little sexual fantasies, and the entertainment of going, these are two things I am pursuing. And in verse 9, he says this, "So I became greater than all who had lived in Jerusalem before me, and my wisdom never failed me." So the last two things we see is this, he had also with everything else, greatness and fame. So everybody knew who he was worldwide. Everyone knew who Solomon was. So he had fame and he had greatness. And he pursued those things out and had it to an extent that no one else had ever actually experienced. Now, as you look through all that, I think that pretty much covers all the general paths that you can pursue to try to find meaning in possessions and in pleasure. Okay? I think that pretty much covers all the different avenues humans can go. But just in case he missed something, he says this in verse 10. So to kind of sum it all up, he says this. He says, "Anything I wanted, I would take." So in case I missed something, just so you know, anything I wanted, I got. That's what I did. And he says, "I denied myself no pleasure." So anything that came in my head I thought would give me pleasure, I pursued, and I did, and I accomplished. "I even found great pleasure," he says, "in hard work, a reward for all my labors." That even I even found it in the hard work. Like maybe that would give me the pleasure. Maybe that would give me meaning. And he found it in that. Now here's the interesting thing. He does all these things to an extent that none of us in this room can ever imagine. But we all think if we could experience it to the extent that he did, we would find our meaning. And that, again, that's how Satan gets us. He always goes, the reason you didn't find it is because you have limits. Solomon didn't. So he had no limits. He goes full, as far as you can in all these things. And here was his conclusion after doing all this stuff in this period of his life. Verse 11, he says this, "But I looked at everything I had worked so hard to accomplish. It was all meaningless. It was all heaven." Okay? Like chasing after a wind. There was nothing really worthwhile anywhere. That's his conclusion. I did everything. I pursued every pleasure. I acquired every possession. I did everything you all dream of. And at the end of the day, what did I get? Nothing. I still don't feel like I have meaning. I have nothing. Okay? Now, how can this be? How can it be that you can pursue without limits all pleasure and all acquiring of possessions that you want and still end up with heaven? How is that possible? Because we are all convinced, I think part of our human nature being Americans, we've all convinced ourselves, no, you can't find meaning in that stuff. It would solve so many of our problems if we could just have untapped resources to do these things. And he didn't. He didn't find meaning in it. It was still heaven. How is that? Let me give you four things that I know that come from Scripture that clearly explain to us why the pursuit of possessions and pleasure will never bring you meaning. You will always be left the same place you were or even worse because you'll have all the garbage linked to it or worse than where you started, okay? Here are the four things we know about the pursuit of pleasure and possessions. Number one is this. It is not a new pursuit. The reason we know this is straight off, Solomon lived thousands of years ago, okay? So about 3,000 years ago, and he's describing the same things we pursue today 3,000 years later. You look throughout history, we see the same cycle over and over and over and over again of people desiring these things and trying to attain these things. We see it over and over again. In 1 Timothy, so Paul writes this 2,000 years ago to the early church in Timothy. He says this, "But people who long to be rich fall into temptations and are trapped by many foolish and harmful desires that plunge them into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and some people craving money have wandered from the true faith and pierced themselves with many sorrows." Okay? This is not a new pursuit. This is not a new thought process like, oh, I'm the first one to think maybe I can find meaning in pleasure and possessions. This isn't something new. The second thing we know about this pursuit of possessions and pleasure is this. It will never satisfy your desire for meaning. Never. You will never find satisfaction in it. Luke chapter 12, Jesus says this. He says, "Beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured by how much you what? Own." There is something instinctively in us that we know how much we own, how much we accomplish, how much pleasure we put in our lives temporarily, there's something instinctively in us that lets us know, we know that's not how life is valued. And that's why we always end up with heaven, is we're not designed that way. There's something in our design that tells us that's not where you find meaning. That's not where you're going to find purpose. That's not where you're ever going to find satisfaction. Because you know you're not measured by the stuff you own and you attain. And let me tell you why we know this instinctively. Because we see people buried every day. We see people die around us every day. And the moment you die, none of that stuff has value. Your house doesn't get buried with you. Your money doesn't get buried with you. You get buried in a suit or a dress and they bury you. And that's all that goes with you. And at that point, you're already gone anyways. It has zero value. And instinctively, I think we see that constantly. We kind of know that. But Satan deceives us and makes us go, no, you can't find meaning in these things. If I pursue pleasure, if I pursue possessions, and that's I can still find meaning. And at the end of the day, the reality smacks us in the face and says, no, you can't. You're never going to find the meaning, the thing you're looking for in those things, absent of God. You're just never going to find. Here's the third thing in this pursuit we know, which is this. It will destroy your spiritual life. Okay? If you decide to try to find purpose and meaning in the pursuit of pleasure and possessions absent of God, what we know clear as day is this. It will destroy your spiritual life. In Luke 8, Jesus says this. He gives a parable. It's called the parable of the seeds. And there's four seeds, and he talks about this farmer who goes out and throws seed all over the place and talks about how the seed grew up. And of the four seeds, one of them actually grew up healthy to produce more seeds, okay? In this case, he talks about the one seed that falls amongst thorns. So one of the seeds actually falls amongst thorns, and it says it gets choked out by the weeds around it and stuff like that, and it dies, all right? And here's what he says at the end when he's explaining it. He says, the seed that fell among the thorns represents those who hear the message, but all too quickly the message is crowded out by the cares, riches and pleasure of this life, and so they never grow into maturity. Okay, it's very interesting when you look at the detailed words of Solomon 3,000 years ago, and then you look at Jesus's words here, who perfectly describes everything Solomon just described to you as you pursue. Okay, and it just says here, your relationship with God will be crowded out by your cares and your desires to attain riches and pleasures of this life. And you will never grow. And so you will always be left spiritually immature, desiring more, but never being able to find it. Okay? And so we know that to be true, that if you make the pursuit of these two things in your life primary, you will die spiritually. Your spiritual walk will suffer. There's no way around it. So here's the last thing I want to look at then is this. What is the answer to being able to find meaning in the pursuit of pleasure and possessions? Because I would say this, desiring to have pleasure in your life, desiring to have some possessions in your life aren't evil things. Okay, them just in amongst themselves and to themselves, they're not always evil pursuits. Okay? What makes them bad pursuits is this, when you do them with the absence of God, and when you're doing it without the desire to honor God with your pleasure and possessions. That's where you get yourself in a mess. Okay? Here's what it says in 1 Timothy 6, which gives us the answer of how can you find meaning in the pursuit of pleasure and possessions. Here's what it says. It says, teach those who are rich in this world, Americans, okay? Teach those who are rich in this world not to be proud and not to trust in their money, which is so unreliable. So let me just cover this sentence by sentence. As Americans, we find a ton of pride, and we find a ton of trust in our money, do we not? Let's just be honest here. The more money I have in my bank account, the more stable I feel in life. The more money I have in my bank account, the more control I feel like I have in life. We trust it a lot, and we have a ton of pride in it, because we also do this. If I have more money than him, in my mind, I'm better than he is. If he has more money than her, his mind, he's better than her. That's how we judge an American. That's how our mindset is programmed from the time we are infants. And so this verse is directly attacking our mindset, where he says, teach those who are rich in this world not to be prideful that way, not to trust in their money, and he tells you why. Because it's totally unreliable. Okay? How many of you are feeling the effects of inflation right now? Okay? You go to the grocery store. Stuff probably 4% than it was just a couple of years ago, was it not? Like, we just bought groceries yesterday. It was like a little over $200. And you look at what you got, and you're like, I don't think I ever spent over $200 2 years ago, and I had a lot more stuff in my car. It's crazy. And what you start to find out is inflation can ruin your reliability of your money. Events can ruin the reliability of your money. If you just lost stuff through the storm, like we just did, we're sitting there like, we're going to have to spend hundreds of dollars to replace our fencing now. And so that's just money that's going to go out that we thought we had. And you start going, it's totally unreliable. Events and circumstances can suck your bank accounts down to nothing. Countries can fail. Bankruptcies can happen. All sorts of stuff like that let us know it's unreliable. Yet, we put a ton of pride and trust in it, and it's silly. And that's what we're being told by Paul. It's silly. You know it's unreliable. Then he says this. Here's the answer. Their trust should be in what? God. Their trust should be in God, who richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment. So it goes, as we talked about this last week, your trust should be in God. And if you trust him, he will give you all the things you want for your enjoyment. He'll give you those things. Doesn't mean he'll give you wealth. Doesn't mean he'll give you possessions and all that of your dreams. It's just when he will change the inside of you and transform you, where you will find what you're looking for in your relationship with him. As we talked last week, it's about honoring God. What honoring God simply means is this. In everything I do in my life, I'm trying to please him. Every decision I make in my life, I'm just trying to please him. That's my motivating factor in everything. Everything I'm doing, am I pleasing God? And that's how you look to honor him. That's how you look to please him, is going, God, this is my mindset. Everything's about you and honoring you and pleasing you. Are you happy with this? Then he says this. Tell them, so tell you, to use their money to do what? Good. Not to buy your possessions, not to spend it all on you, not to do good. Use your money to do good. They should be rich in what? Good works. And generous to those in need, always being ready to share with others. So then we're told about this. If your money that you get, you should use it to share with others. You should do good deeds for people and perform good works for people and serve people with it and impact other people and help other people with the money that you have. And that is the answer to actually finding meaning in pleasure and in possessions, is when those things are focused on other people. And then you find meaning. In 19, he says this. He says, by doing this, they will be storing up their treasures as a good foundation for the future, so they may experience what? True life. So you may experience true life, meaning you will find meaning. You will find purpose in your pursuit of pleasure and acquiring of possessions, because you're doing it in such a way that honors God. And when you do it with that intent behind it, you then find meaning. When it's about him and not you, now you start to find meaning in the pursuit of possessions and pleasure, because now it's about him, and then he transforms you. Okay? That's the secret to all of it. Here's the deal. Without the desire to honor God in your pursuit of pleasure and possessions, you are destined to end up with only heaven. You are destined to pursue pleasure after pleasure after pleasure, Solomon did. To acquire possession after possession after possession, as Solomon did, and be left in the exact same place he was, which is this, heaven. Feeling like I grabbed it for a moment and then it disappeared. I grabbed it for a moment and it disappeared, and I'm left with nothing. God desires much more for your life than that. God gives you the opportunity to have much more in your life than simply